Good morning and welcome to worship at First Baptist Church. It is great to be able to gather in the house of the Lord this morning. I want to welcome everyone, and I hope that you've had a great week and are preparing for an even greater week to come. I know that there's a lot of transitioning happening, getting back into the swing of things with school and such. And so welcome to this time of worship, and during this time we will have a blessing for the new school year. So welcome to students, welcome to teachers and faculty and administration from various schools. We are glad that you're here and hope this will be an encouraging time of worship. Want to also welcome people who may be visiting us. We are glad that you have chosen to do so, and if you would like to have the church follow up with you and make contact, please tear out a portion of this bulletin that has a little crease you can do so with, and fill it out and put it in the offering plate following worship. And this coming week, we will make contact with you. I'd also like to say a word of welcome to those who are joining us online. We welcome your presence and acknowledge you with us here today, whether you're worshiping with us with the live stream or perhaps catching up and worshiping later in the week. I would like to encourage you, as I do each week, to say hello in the comments section so we can see the community that is gathered online. I do want to remind you this morning that for giving of tithes and offerings, you can do so by placing them in the offering plates located here on the stage on either side and also in the vestibule. You can also give online at firstbaptistfarmville.org. There's a link at the top of the page, or you can mail tithes and offerings to the church or drop them off during the week. As far as announcements goes, there are several here that I want to mention. The first is a love offering that we are taking from September 1st to September 22nd. And if you do want to contribute today, you may go ahead and do that. But this is for Carney Hedgepeth. Carney is the pastor at Bell Arthur Christian Church. And many of you have seen him on our prayer list for, I think it's been a couple of months now. He had back in the early summer, late spring, he had an accident on a motorcycle. A car hit him, and so there's been a long road of recovery for him. And so you can give to this love offering, and the H.D. Johnson Fund will be matching up to $5,000 in contributions to that. If you have any questions, you can see us, but it pretty much is self-explanatory there in the bulletin. There's all the information there. But also, in addition to contributing to this love offering, do continue to pray for Carney Hedgepeth, for his family, and for his church family. This afternoon from 3 to 6, there is a pool party at Carl and Julia Bonner's home, and this is rescheduled from last week when we found out that the Farmville pool at the time was green and not accepting customers. And so if you're bringing children to that, please bring swimsuits, towels, and sunscreen. This afternoon at 4:30, the youth are having their back-to-school bash, which includes going to the creamery for ice cream and then coming back and having a shaving cream battle. Do want to also let you know the youth are collecting or having a food and clothing drive. All of that will be going for the Kennedy home that is located in Kinston. That's going on through November the 6th, 2022. We will be getting highlighting that weekly, though, and giving more specifics as the time gets closer, but we have a couple of months of doing that collection. Also, want to remind you that today we are having a covered dish lunch following worship, so we invite you to come to the fellowship hall for that, and look forward to sharing a meal together. At this time, I invite you to join your hearts with me in prayer as we begin this time of worship. Holy Father, we give you thanks for this time and this place and this encounter that we are having with you. We thank you that you are with us wherever we go, but as we gather together as your body, you are with us in a very special way. And we pray that you would give us encouragement today through your word, through prayer, through worship, through song. We pray that all of these things would work together to help us become the people that you're calling us to be and to be the church that you've called us to be in the Farmville community and the community beyond. It's in Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen. Our psalm reading this morning comes from Psalm 80, verses 1 through 2 and 8 through 19. Hear us, Shepherd of Israel, you who lead Joseph like a flock, you who sit enthroned between the cherubim. Shine forth before Ephraim, Benjamin, and Manasseh. Awaken your might. Come and save us. You transplanted a vine from Egypt. You drove out the nations and planted it. You cleared the ground for it, and it took root and filled the land. The mountains were covered with its shade, the mighty cedars with its branches. Its branches reached as far as the sea, its shoots as far as the river. Why have you broken down its walls so that all who pass by pick its grapes? Boars from the forest ravage it, and insects from the fields feed on it. Return to us, God Almighty. Look down from heaven and see. Watch over this vine, the root your right hand has planted, the sun you have raised up for yourself. Your vine is cut down, it is burned with fire. At your rebuke, your people perish. Let your hand rest on the man at your right hand, the son of man you have raised up for yourself. Then we will not turn away from you. Revive us, and we will call on your name. Restore us, Lord God Almighty. Make your face shine on us, that we may be saved. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. At this time, I invite you to stand as we sing and worship. It is well.
Thank you.
Please be seated. This morning, as we begin the morning prayer, I'd like to encourage you to take your bulletin for a moment and let's spend a couple of minutes praying silently where we are for some of the people on our prayer list. If you would pick a few and do so, and at the conclusion of that, I will then have the morning prayer. Let us pray. Father God, we give you thanks for this family of faith. As we gather here in this room, we are among brothers and sisters, and we thank you that you're our Father. We thank you that you have given the gift of your Son, Jesus, so that we might have salvation. And God, as we put our faith in Jesus, your Holy Spirit, your very self comes and dwells in us. So we give you thanks that as we gather, we're not just people happening to like the same things or be in the same room at the same time, but we are family. We are called to be family to one another. We give you thanks for those members and friends and people who are on our prayer list this morning. We give thanks for the opportunities that we have to pray for them and to love them and to go along the journey with them for healing, and we pray for healing for them. We pray that you would answer prayers in these brothers and sisters' lives. Lord, where their lives feel chaotic right now, we pray that you would give them peace. Where there is sickness and disease, God, we pray that you would bring them healing. We know their journeys are tough. And we know the burden that they carry can be very overwhelming for them and them alone. So we pray that you would show us how we can be your hands and feet alongside of them to help carry their burden, to show them love, and to be a display of the goodness of Jesus Christ in their lives. God, we thank you for our church family and for the call that we have to make disciples of you. And we pray that each Sunday as we come and worship you, that the overflow of that would be us sharing what you were doing in our lives with others. We pray that you would make First Baptist Church a strong beacon, a bright light for you, for your gospel, for your good news, and for your hope that is found only in Jesus Christ. We pray that you would continue to grow this family, that you would bring people who aren't plugged into a spiritual family, into the hope that is found in Jesus, and bring them here and allow them to be grafted into the vine that is our church. We pray as this school year approaches, Lord, that you would allow our students and teachers and faculty and administration to experience a great year. And we thank you for the opportunity we have to lay a blessing upon them this morning. So God, we thank you for this time of worship. We thank you that it, as we continue, we do so in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. Amen.
This morning I have several scriptures to read for you. The first comes from Joshua 1:9. This is my command. Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid or discouraged. For the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. The next one comes from Philippians 4:6-7. Don't worry about anything. Instead, pray about everything. Tell God what you need and thank him for all he has done. Then you will experience God's peace, which exceeds anything we can understand. His peace will guard your hearts and minds as you live in Christ Jesus. And then from 1 Corinthians 16:13 and 14. Be on guard. Stand firm in the faith. Be courageous. Be strong. And do everything with love. Tomorrow is a big day. We have the back to school. So our students go back into the classrooms tomorrow. Our teachers and administrators have already been there. It's a big day. Lots of changes all the time. So we want to pray for our students and our administrators and teachers. We want to send them and let them start on the best possible footing. It's hard starting a new school year sometimes. You could be new to the school with no friends yet. Or it's just a big step going from elementary to middle or middle to high school, or you're getting ready to graduate at the end of the year. Different things happen. Our students are under so much stress these days. We want to let them know that we're behind them and that we love them. And there's a couple more scripture verses that I'm going to share with you that talks about having the students have faith, us having faith. And we want students, I want you guys to hear these as well. I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength, from Philippians 4:13. You can do anything and face anything because God's with you. Trust in the Lord with all thine heart and lean not into thine own understanding. In all the ways acknowledge him and he shall direct thy path. Proverbs 3:5-6. God's got you. God is there. Acknowledge him, pray, and he's going to be there regardless. And then, what time I am afraid, I will trust in thee. In God I will praise his word. In God I have put my trust. I will not fear what flesh can do unto me. From Psalms 56:3-4. Trust God, students, administrators, and teachers, and he's going to see you through everything. Up here, for the students today, we have pencils. These pencils have been prayed over by the Sunday school classes, by me, by Graham, and we're going to pray together as a congregation over all of these pencils. And on this side, for teachers and administrators, I have a little bag that they can take. This has all been prayed over, and we're going to pray over students and administrators in just a moment. And that's what I'm going to ask now. If all my students will kind of come down to the side, whether you're from little on up to college, grad, medical, whatever, if you're taking some classes, we would like you to come down. Come here, Lillian. Will you come with me? Okay, it's okay. Come on. My big ones too. Administrators, teachers, Brad, we know you're up there, so we know you can't come down, but Brad is up there in the sound booth. Y'all can kind of come this way. Come this way. Because I'm asking you to. Stand right here. Fill in. Shh. Jensen, y'all come up, stand over here. Stand in front. Because I'm asking you to. Because I'm asking you to. All right, now with like all parents, rest of the congregation to stand and let's surround them in love and prayer. So if everybody will stand and kind of just gather around them as close as you feel comfortable and if you're able to stand. And y'all can come forward if you would like. Stand and gather around them. Put your hands on them if you're able. We're going to start with a few minutes of silent prayer. just pray over them, and then I'll close us. So let's pray. Creator God, thank you so much for all these students, our teachers, our administrators. Lord, we ask that you give them the strength, the courage, and just the excitement to start the new year. We ask that you lead them and guide their footsteps and their thoughts. Give them strength to stand up when they need it and help someone there to pick them up when they know they need it. Lord, we ask that you just let them soar on your wings all year long. And help them know that they have this entire congregation and so many more people standing behind them, Lord. So just guide them, lead them, direct them, and let them know they are loved by you and all of us. It's in your name we pray. Amen. All right, students, teachers, y'all can grab what's on the pulpit. Little ones can come with me, and thank y'all.
Last week, I began a sermon series about faith. It's a three-week series, and so we naturally are in week two of that three-week series. We're looking at the book of Hebrews, which was written by an unknown author. However, we do know that this unknown author addressed it to Jewish and Gentile Christians with two primary themes. The first is to encourage Christians to endure, and the second is warnings not to abandon faith in Jesus. A question that I posed to you last week and that I bring again and that I'll bring next week is to ask you to reflect over the life of faith that you are living. How is your journey of faith in Jesus? Now, it's tempting to think of a person in our lives or a person we've known who has exemplified the most extreme faith under the most extreme circumstances. And so I'm not asking you to measure yourself to someone else, but to take a genuine reflection of yourself and think about ways that you can take steps with the Lord in the coming weeks, in the coming days, to strengthen your faith. To give a recap from last week, we looked at Hebrews chapter 11, verses 1 through 3, where we read these famous words. Faith is confidence in what we hope for and assurance about what we do not see. Confidence in what we hope for and assurance about what we do not see. I told you last week that faith is not sight. Faith is not if it were something that we could see, if God was, you know, was here in physical form, Jesus was sitting right here, then faith would be so easy, wouldn't it? Like, have you ever thought about, like, what if the thing you were going through in your life, all of a sudden Jesus was, like, for 5 minutes, you had just Jesus was there, and, like, you know, just imagine how that would inform your faith forever. We see what it did to, in fact, to the disciples. You know, there were 12 disciples. Judas betrayed Jesus, but the 11 disciples, when Jesus was put on the cross and he died, they fled, didn't they? They ran, they were gone. However, when Jesus reappeared to them physically, their lives were forever changed. They were no longer these fearful people trying to follow Jesus. They were resolute in their dedication to the Lord. In fact, they were martyred for their faith. They willingly suffered death because they had seen the risen Jesus. But it's not so easy for us. It's not so easy because Jesus has ascended into heaven and he sent his Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit, by definition, in the New Testament, is given the word pneuma, which means breath or wind, air. You take a breath, you feel it. It gives you what you need, the oxygen and filling your lungs, yet we don't see it, do we? So faith is one of those things that is tough. It's something that we do not see, that is not born out of sight. However, when we grow in faith, it is a kind of seeing, isn't it? Many of us came to faith in Jesus because of how we saw and experienced Jesus through the Scriptures, or maybe saw and experienced Jesus from someone else that we love. We saw their faith in action. So while faith isn't something and all about seeing, again, it's by definition confidence in what we hope for and assurance about what we do not see, there is a kind of seeing in which we can experience the Lord. Secondly, I talked to you last week about how faith is not supported by the dominant culture. I talked to you about the Christians that grew up during this time and that this letter was addressed to, and they were in this Greek-Roman empire, which celebrated the worship of all the gods, the Greek mythological gods. In fact, in Rome, Paul would walk into town and he would talk to them, he would debate with them about all of these gods. There was a statue to all the gods, all the Greek gods, all the pagan ritualistic gods. In fact, they wanted to make sure they covered all their bases. They had a statue to the unknown god. And so Paul said, let me tell you about him, because he's the only one who's real. Let me tell you about the God of heaven and earth, the one who has been revealed through Jesus Christ. But for them, for these Christians that grew up in this Greek-Roman Empire, for them, what was expected of them by the dominant culture was for them to go and to worship not only their God, but to worship every single other God. And they weren't a good civilian unless they did all of those things. Do you think they did it? They were persecuted, in fact, because they did not. They were seen as being as being against the dominant culture of the day because they didn't worship the way everyone else worshiped. They worshiped the God of heaven and earth and God only. Faith is not supported by a dominant culture. We shouldn't look elsewhere to to grow our faith, the only place we can look is in the Scriptures. Look at Jesus, worship the Lord for faith to grow. And last week also talked about how our journey of faith is rooted in Abraham and Sarah's journey, that they would be a blessing to all the earth. And so we are called to be a blessing to others. And so if in your journey of life and your journey of faith, if all we're worried about is ourselves and how we grow and what experience we have, we're not doing it completely right. Because we're meant to be a blessing to all the nations, to all people, beginning with our family, beginning with our community, and reaching out in concentric circles. Last week I closed the service, and I want to mention that illustration again, because for me, when I was doing my research for the sermon series, God really spoke to me through it. So back in, I've mentioned already, you know, about the polytheistic Greek Roman culture where they worshiped all the gods and such. One of the ones they worshiped was Pandora. And if you've been, you know, in maybe your literature classes, you probably learned, there was a section you learned about Greek mythology, and Pandora was the Greek goddess who had the little box that had, inside the box, there was all the evils and there were the blessings. And so for these people, they believed that the inside of Pandora's box, that the blessing called pistis, which is the Greek word for faith, trust, and reliability, that one had actually escaped the box. And it had fled earth, such that trust, faith, reliability, those things weren't on earth any longer. When Luke chapter 18, verses 1 through 8, Jesus is talking to his disciples and he tells them a parable. And in this parable, he talks about this persistent widow and this unjust judge. And basically, the judge finally grants the widow her wishes, not because it was the right and just thing to do, but because the widow just would not leave him alone. And we see that in verse 8, Jesus says to them, he's talking about God and how, you know, if an unjust judge ends up doing the right thing, how much more so will God do the right thing, that he can be trusted. He says in verse 8 of 18, the Gospel of Luke, I tell you, he will see that they get justice and quickly. However, when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith? Will he find pistis? Will he find trust? Reliability, will he find these things on earth? He's basically saying, will you trust in God even though the whole culture believes all of those things have escaped? They're not attainable any longer. In Luke chapter 18, verse 1, the way he begins this parable, Luke writes this. He says, Jesus told his disciples a parable to show them that they should always pray and never give up. The whole purpose of this, and in the end asking them, will God find faith in you, is to tell them you should never give up. You should always pray. You should always be seeking the kingdom. I think that's good encouragement for us. Amen? Amen. Because we find ourselves, if you're hearing my voice, if you're alive this morning, the reality is that we all live a life that requires faith. And the older we get, the more that's revealed through our declining health, through work and career issues, personal struggles, addictions, sins, maybe struggles we're carrying for someone else that are really, really, really heavy for them and heavy for us as we carry them. School's coming up, and for some of y'all, you can't wait for school. For others, you're like, oh my goodness, I don't know how I'm going to get through this year. Or maybe we have dreams and passions that require a lot of faith. God has placed this calling in our lives to be His shining light in this certain way. And it's a calling that He's given us. But we don't know what the next step is. If you're alive, again, and hearing my voice this morning, or at some time way off in the future online, let me tell you, we all live lives that require faith. We all live lives that we need to listen to Jesus in Luke 18:1, where he says we should always pray and we should not give up. So today, as we continue this series and dive back into Hebrews, my prayer is that you will do, again, the things that are necessary to take steps of faith, to grow your faith today. in Jesus through the trials and the travels of life that do require faith. This morning we're going to go a little further in Hebrews chapter 11. We're going to begin with Hebrews chapter 11 verse 29 and read through Hebrews chapter 12 verse 3. And this is what the writer says. By faith the people passed through the Red Sea as on dry land. But when the Egyptians tried to do so, they were drowned. By faith the walls of Jericho fell after the army had marched around them for 7 days. By faith the prostitute Rahab, because she welcomed the spies, was not killed with those who were disobedient. And what more shall I say? I do not have time to tell about Gideon, Barak, Samson, and Jephthah, about David and Samuel and the prophets, who through faith conquered kingdoms, administered justice, and gained what was promised, who shut the mouths of lions, quenched the fury of the flames, and escaped the edge of the sword, whose weakness was turned to strength, and who became powerful in battle and routed foreign armies. Women received back their dead, raised to life again. I'm just going to stop right there for a minute, because I think that's a good place to introduce the first truth I want to bring to you this morning about the journey of faith. The first one is that the evidence of faith should not be defined by the final result. And we'll say it again. The evidence of our faith should not be defined by the final result. Yet that is so often how we define faith, isn't it? In fact, can you imagine being one of the original hearers of this letter, being encouraged? Let's say the letter had come from the author, and they brought it to this region where these Jewish and Gentile Christian believers are gathered together, and this letter is about to be read, and everyone's gathered, and we want to hear what the word is going to be, and they get to that part, and they read about faith, the faith that the Israelites experienced as they crossed the Red Sea, and then they look back to see the sea swallowing their enemy. And then they hear about Jericho and the walls falling and not a single weapon having to be discharged or used. And about Rahab, this prostitute who found faith and found favor and did the right things and welcomed the spies, and she was not killed. And then these other people, Gideon, Barak, Samson, and Jephthah, and David, and Samuel, which the writer says, I don't have that time to talk about. And the prophets. And then he goes into 33, and through faith they conquered kingdoms, they administered justice, they gained what was promised, who shut the mouths of lions, quenched the fury of flames, and escaped the edge of the sword, whose weakness was turned into strength, and who became powerful in battle and routed foreign armies. Women received back their dead, raised to life again. We hear it, don't we, today? That person, the evidence of their faith is that they were healed from that thing. That they left that job and they found a new one with purpose. That they overcame their personal struggle with that addiction and that sin. That they walked alongside of that person during their time of need and they saw restoration. That they finally graduated from high school. That they followed their dreams and passions. That they fulfilled God's calling in their lives. You know, we can probably find a church that'll tell us those things, but that's not reality. That's not real living, is it? The writer here knows that as well, because he goes on and says there were others who were tortured, refusing to be released so that they might gain an even better resurrection. Some faced jeers and flogging and even chains and imprisonment. They were put to death by stoning. They were sawed in two. They were killed by the sword. They went about in sheepskins and goatskins, destitute, persecuted, and mistreated. The world was not worthy of them. They wandered in deserts and mountains, living in caves and in holes in the ground. That doesn't sound like living your best life, does it? But it might be, if it's a life of faith. Verse 39, the writer says, these were all commended, not because of their final result, but because of their faith. They didn't receive what had been promised, since God had planned something better for us, so that only together with us would they be made perfect. That's a hard truth, but it's one we need to come to terms with. Is that the evidence of us living lives of faith is not in where we end up landing, where things finally come together and look perfect. But the evidence of faith is trust and hope and confidence in God in the midst of the hardest times of life. Belief that God is good, that He's fully loving, that He is worthy of our worship, and that He is worthy to be trusted. The second thing that I would say this morning is that we don't have to journey. We don't have to journey alone. I have no doubt that there are some people here in this room right now who feel alone. The Bible is pretty specific. There are places all over the Scriptures where it talks about how man is not created, woman is not created, people are not created to live life alone. Genesis 2:18 describes marriage. It says, "The Lord God said, it is not good for the man to be alone. I'll make him a helper suitable for him." Ecclesiastes 4:9 talks about people working together. Two are better than one because they have a good return for their labor. John 14:16 talks about how God knew that we didn't need to be alone. So when Jesus went and ascended into heaven, He gave us the Holy Spirit. He says, "I will ask the Father, and He will give you another advocate to help with you and be with you forever, the Holy Spirit." Matthew 28:20, when Jesus gives the Great Commission, He says, "I am surely with you always to the very end of the age." How many of y'all like hunting? Anybody? We got a few hunters in here. How about Animal Planet? Anybody like Animal Planet? Yeah. Everybody's awake, right? Okay, so think about the lion, okay? The lion's on the prowl. The lion goes looking for a feast. There's a big old pile of antelope out there. Are they just going to rush in and go after all of them? They're going to pick off the one that looks weakest, aren't they? Most of the time, they pick out the one that's all by itself. 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 8 through 9, the Apostle Peter says, "Be alert and of sober mind. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. Resist him, standing firm in the faith, because you know that the family of believers throughout the world is undergoing the same kind of sufferings." One of the worst things that we can do to our fellow believers is act like we're strong and have it all together. And we might be stronger than them. We might be stronger than others. But if we take an honest look at ourselves, all of us have weaknesses. All of us have to journey this life of faith. And we do it better journeying together. We don't have to journey alone. I love where the writer continues here. In our Bible, we have chapters, you know, that's how they broke down chapters and verses, but the original writer was just writing. And so don't pay too much attention to this changes chapters, but the thought is there where he says, therefore, talking about all these things, talking about the way that faith sometimes is really easy and we get to the mountaintop experience, but for others of us, faith is being in that valley. The writer says, therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us. I want to stop there for a moment and just tell you, it can be very easy for us to know the race that is before us, but to check out completely. You know, I've shared with y'all last week some of the stuff our family has endured, and again, I share that not to complain, but to explain. I hope I was real clear with that this past last week. I will be honest. On Tuesday, I had a talk with Miss Shirley Davis. Shirley and Cedric are always online. Hey, Miss Shirley, and I did tell Shirley that I might be at the point that I needed to complain just a little bit, because the house had backed up again, y'all. Anyway. But I said, I'm just going to explain. I'm not going to complain. I'm going to explain. But we've been through it. And this, you know, it's continued to not get any easier. But I can tell you the temptation there to check out and not run the race is everywhere. Most of us have these little devices. And we got things like Netflix and Amazon Prime, which I don't know about y'all. I was telling some people this morning, but my address in Farmville no longer gets two-day shipments from Amazon. We got to band together and do something about that because that is an issue, okay? Anyway, and just so you know, I put in some other people's addresses just around Farmville just to see what would happen, and it was the same thing, okay? So I wasn't going to ship y'all anything, though. But we got videos. We got Disney Plus, Hulu. You know, we can go and we can numb ourselves to whatever it is. We can check out and just let it pass. There's news outlets where we can read and get jacked up out of our mind and worried and anxious for days. But the scriptures here say that we are called to run the race. Let us run with perseverance the race. So let me encourage you this morning. You might be on the sidelines of your race and not even realize it. You might be sitting on the sidelines and watching people run by. You're wondering why your faith doesn't look as vibrant as theirs. And the truth is you're sitting down. You're not moving your legs. You don't have to journey alone. Be encouraged by someone else. Encourage brothers and sisters. We are not meant to live this life alone. The third thing I'll say this morning is that and this is back to your, you know, maybe this morning you're wondering, well, how can I develop my faith? How can I grow in my faith? How can my faith, you know, look like Jesus's faith? You know, see him in the Gospels. Well, the very next verse says this, okay? I'm glad you asked and were wondering. Fixing our eyes on Jesus, the author, the pioneer, and perfecter of our faith. For the joy set before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured such opposition from sinners so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. You know, I talked last week about our journey of faith being rooted in Abraham and Sarah's journey to be a blessing to other people. The fulfillment, though, of the faith that began in them was fulfilled in Jesus Christ, the very Son of God, the gospel good news for all the world, that whoever would put their faith in Jesus would not perish but would receive eternal life, blessing and presence with God forever and ever and ever. It's easy, though, for us to rely on something else, isn't it? Some encouragement from a podcast or maybe a sermon we see on YouTube or maybe what the pastor says on Sunday or what comes up in our Sunday school class. But every one of us, if we don't have one, we do have free access to the Holy Scriptures, the very Word of God. I heard one pastor when I was a teenager, he said this. He said, if you would with me open up to your copy of the Word of God. And I never, for whatever reason, really thought about that my Bible is it's the Word of God in my hands. Like, I have access to the thoughts of God. I have access to a library, 66 books here that cover about 30 centuries of the movement of God among people. Can you imagine the wealth of knowledge here, yet sometimes we open it and try to play Russian roulette with the, you know, Bible roulette where you just kind of, you know, what's the Lord got for me today? And it's, your hands have made me, inform me, give me understanding to learn your commands. I don't know how that applies. Just one verse and we shut it. I'm done with that. I will tell you this. I'm not trying to judge myself based on other people's faith, but the people I have known in life who've gone through the most harsh circumstances in life, yet have done it trusting fully in God, are people who are students of the Word of God. They've hidden the Word of God in their heart, and it's affected their course of their whole lives. So if you're wondering how you see Jesus, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John are four good places to start. But back to what the writer says. It says, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and the perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him, he endured the cross. You know, we have the example here of Jesus going in willingly enduring with joy the cross, scorning its shame, and he sets down at the right hand of the throne of God. Continues, consider him who endured such opposition from sinners so that you won't grow weary and lose heart. I have found this to be true in my life. that when I fix my eyes on Jesus and I walk in strength, it doesn't take very long to put your eyes on something else, does it? We have to continually go to the well of living water, to the wellspring of life, to fix our eyes on Jesus. It's always been for me, and as a pastor, as I spend time talking with others, especially people who are older than me, people in their 70s and their 80s and their 90s, when they talk about their faith journeys, you know, they'll talk about the things that were highlights and things that came easy. But when they really start talking about an experience with the Lord, like a mountaintop experience, like they see God in everything, it's not been in the easy times, it has been in the hardest moments of life. It's been in those hardest experiences. I think that's why James, the half-brother of Jesus, writes in James chapter 1, verse 2 through 4, he says, "Consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters, whenever you face trials of many kinds, because you know that the testing of your faith produces perseverance. Let perseverance finish its work so that you may be mature and complete, not lacking anything." As I close this morning, I want to share an experience that I had that I found to be one of the greatest experiences in my life outside of, you know, outside of the faith, though. I've shared with you before that I was a cyclist in college and raced bicycles, and there were races that I won, and of course, you know, I was elated when I won those things. But there was a ride that I did called Mountains of Misery in Southwest Virginia, 128 miles over several thousand feet of climbing. I can't remember that statistic. It took 8.5 hours to ride the route. There were something like 8 mountain ranges that we ended up having to climb, and it finished with a mountaintop climb. There were something like 400 or 500 people who began this ride together. We began in a group, and this wasn't a race, okay? But just so you know, if you ever see a cyclist out riding, anytime you're on the bike with another person, it's a race, okay? So just because it wasn't an official race, it was a race. And as we started out, about 45 to 50 of us kind of broke out the front of this group. And after about 20 miles, I was like, I'm not going to make it. These dudes are going really fast. And after a couple hours, I also needed to stop for a bathroom break. So a lot of coffee that morning to get me going, if you know what I mean. So I find me a nice little rest stop and stop. And I'm like, you know what? I was going in this thing hoping I'd finish, you know, good, this unofficial race. And I decided, this is going to be tough. This is going to take a whole lot of hard work. And so I continued along my journey. And every now and then I'd come up close to somebody and I'd ride along with them and we'd have conversation, or someone would come from behind me and would join up and we would ride together 5 or 10 miles and then I'd be on my own again. And this finish at the very end, this grueling uphill, going up a mountain finish, was very, very, very tough. It wasn't a straight line deal. It's a, you know, you're weaving on the road like this. I didn't think I was going to make it. But by the time I reached the top of this mountain, fully exhausted, 8.5 hours into it, I found out that I finished 6th place among all these riders. Now, 2 guys had finished about an hour ahead who were professional cyclists. But I sat down near the finish line, and I spent, some folks brought me bananas and juice and different things that I needed to stay alive after that experience. But I just sat there and watched person after person after person for about an hour, hour and a half, cross that finish line. And although it was an unofficial race for everyone, the joy at finishing, the joy at coming to the end, was worth it. It was worth that experience. Throughout that ride, there were times where I was really questioning what I was doing. Was this really, like, I could probably be at home right now, kicking back, relaxing, watching TV or something, instead of being on this bicycle with this itty-bitty little seat on it and trying to ride up these mountains as quick as I can. But it was a fun experience. I don't know if I've shared with you very much about myself during that time, but I grew up knowing the calling that God had on my life. And I ran from it. I went to NC State and I ran for 2 years. I was a prodigal son. I joined a fraternity. I did things that were not godly, that were not righteous. And I'm thankful that God forgave me of those sinful actions, those habits and such. I'm thankful that God was patient with me. And over the next 2 years, that's when I became a cyclist. I tell people that I wasn't alone on those bicycle rides. I would spend 400 or 500 miles on a bicycle a week during the training. And I looked like I was by myself most of the time, but I was with the Lord. I was delighting in the Lord. I was praying. I was spending that time with Him. There was always a song in my heart and in my mind. It was a time of growth. And the Lord taught me something during that bicycle ride, something that I wouldn't learn on any of the other races or anything else that I ever did as a cyclist during that time. He taught me perseverance. He taught me that that's what faith looks like. Sometimes you're with the pack. Sometimes you got to slow down and take care of yourself, pace yourself a little bit. There are going to be people who come along the journey who God sends there to give you encouragement. There are going to be other people that God sends you to give encouragement. That is what the journey of faith is like. But we do fix our eyes on Jesus. He's the pioneer and the perfecter. Please pray with me. Father God, we give you thanks for this day. We give you thanks for the hard things in life and the ways that you use those hard things to develop our perseverance, to develop our faith. I know that there are brothers and sisters in this room right now. There are those who are listening online right now who are going through really, really hard things. And God, we thank you that as we journey through hard seasons, you are there. We thank you that we can trust you, that you can be found worthy, fully loving, and good. I pray for my brothers and sisters to trust only in you, to give you glory, to give you honor, to give you praise, to fix their eyes on Jesus as they run the race. God, I know there are others of us who may be on the sidelines in life and in faith. We need to get up. We need to start running. We need to start journeying. We need to start pursuing you. We need to take those steps. God, we haven't been promised that when these trials of life come that it's going to be easy, but we have been promised in the Scriptures that you are preparing a better place for us. We have been promised in Revelation that there will be a day that there's no crying, mourning, pain, death, all of those things pass away, that we will be fully in the presence of you, that if our names are written in the book of life, and if we've trusted in Jesus for salvation, you've written our names in that book of life, that book of righteous children of the Lord, that when you look at us, you don't see us as sinners and people who have fallen, but because of our faith we've put in Jesus, you see us as your sons and your daughters. We thank you that if our names are written in the book of life, Lord, that we will experience heaven, that we will experience eternity with you forever and forever. But God, give us the strength. Give us the courage to endure in these journeys of faith. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I want to invite you now as we continue to worship, to stand and sing, "I Give You My Heart." Thank you. stay. The covered dish luncheon will begin following this benediction. So let us pray. Father, we thank you again for this time of worship today. We thank you for the lives that you are calling us to live for you. We thank you for the journey of faith. And while it's not always easy, we thank you that as we give you ourselves and fix our eyes on Jesus, that we can't be led astray. So I pray for this body of Christ, for this church, for us as individuals, that we will run the race marked out with us and find perseverance and allow our faith to grow and develop. And we thank you for the ways that that does become sight for other people to see Jesus. Lord, we thank you for the meal we're going to have now, and we also pray that it will be nourishing to our bodies. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You go in peace. Amen.